All right, hopefully this will just pop right up here. Oh, okay. Let's see. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Now I just gotta make sure that everything shows up here. I'm waiting for everything to load. But I see that it says 25 attendees and everything, so I think everything should be fine. Okay, yeah, he can hear me. All right. I can't see the here, yeah, I guess you just don't see the list of attendees unless they're talking. Okay, all right, we should be fine here. Oh, okay. Okay, yeah, I think everything's fine. I'm ready. Okay, thank you. Okay, everybody, bear with me a little bit. This is the first time that I've used the new software here, so that was me trying to work that out. See, the one thing I need to figure out here is my camera. You're supposed to be back. Yeah, okay. Okay, so I'm just gonna go ahead. There's a few things that I sometimes use as visual aids in this class, but I'm just gonna go ahead and just go over it, you know, just talking. Now that we have the ability to have people ask questions, you know, in real time, I think that if I do it how I used to, it might, you know, take far too long. So if everybody's ready, we can go ahead and jump right into it. Before we get started, can I just ask, like, how many of you in here are higher than a neophyte level? Just go ahead and type it in, or I just want to try to get an idea of the composition of the class and, you know, if it's mostly neophytes or... And you see the video. Yeah, I can turn my camera on. Yeah, I got my camera on now. It's okay. I don't mind that. What I was talking about earlier is the sharing of the screen, not of the webcam. So, but anyway, okay. So looks like we've got some neophytes and some in the elemental grades here. So, okay. So 0, 0, and 1, 10. That's about perfect for this class. Yeah. Okay. Well, with that in mind, then. Let's see, I guess I obviously will be covering the first knowledge lecture from your curriculum of your neophyte theoretical curriculum. And I might touch on some aspects that are also from the practical side of the curriculum, that being, of course, rituals and you know, practice. But before we start with the actual, like, meat of the first knowledge lecture, that being, you know, the elements, the planets, the zodiac signs, etc., the Sephiroth, you know, I like to start these classes. If any of you have been to one of my classes on this subject before, you'll know that I always ask this at the beginning. There's an important underlying concept that isn't covered in the first knowledge lecture, but that is essential to your spiritual development, that you understand it and have an understanding of why you're doing the things you're doing. And so even though it's not material that you need to memorize, it's important enough to talk about that I like to start with it before actually diving into, you know, talking about the elements, for example, which is where we usually start. I'll start with what seems to be a pretty obvious question, and there are no wrong answers. So I'd like, you know, if anyone wants to go ahead and volunteer why they think I'm asking this, that'd be great. So why is it you think that we have to study the knowledge lectures in the first place? Why are they so important and central to our spiritual development? Like I said, there's no wrong answers. There's obviously a lot of different reasons, but there's one specifically that I'm referring to. Why do you think that it's so important that we study these basically, you know, symbolism. Symbolism is basically what we're studying, you know, and memorizing and really churning into our brains. So why is that so important? Does anyone want to take a crack at that? Okay. Foundational understanding of symbols. Okay, so, yeah, I mean, you definitely do need to build a foundational understanding of symbols, and it's essential, a framework for reference. Yeah, so you're gonna obviously be memorizing things and learning things, definitely not just memorizing, learning things for that are nothing is arbitrary. Every single thing you learn, you'll use at some point or another. And all of your answers are completely correct, you know, and valid. But here, Sandra just said, you know, trains your brain to see things differently. Can everybody hear me? I see one person saying can only hear if on YouTube, but can't comment. And then everyone else seems to be okay. Anyway, I'll go on with what I'm doing. So what Sandra said, it trains your brain to see things differently. That's kind of the direction I was going with it. Basically, you know, as we're doing this work, you know, of magic and of transformation, we're kind of obviously operating at different than normal levels of consciousness most of the time, a good amount of the time, you know, whether it's our subconscious or a higher awareness or a higher spiritual plane or a lower plane or, you know, other planes of existence, or at the in the same way, different parts of the self. You'll learn in the, 2-9, I believe, curriculum about the different parts of the self, you know, and there are lots of parts to our consciousness. And the idea here that I'm getting at is that you can't communicate between the two, like between, you know, you and your normal meat suit waking consciousness cannot communicate with these other planes and other consciousness levels, what have you, whether they're within you or whether they're external things, you know, angels, whatnot. You're not going to be able to communicate with them just like you can communicate with me or with another person, just having a casual conversation. Now, that may not always be true. You may get to a point where you can, but, you know, you definitely need to develop in the beginning a very good foundation of symbolism in general. Here, Frater Gimel says, information works in the subconscious level and makes easier the interpretation of symbols from different channels of communication. Exactly. So basically what we're doing is, we're learning to communicate between levels or between planes, like I said, and to do that, we need to use the correct language for that. Hi, Kitty, you joining us? Okay, Bastet is joining us. Anyway, in order to do what we're trying to do, we need to use the correct language, which in this case is the language of the subconscious or that of symbols. So symbols are, of course, the language of the subconscious, and you know, symbols and archetypes and whatnot is how the oldest parts of our brain operate. So it's extremely important when you want to tap into unused or usually unused or in a normal situation unused parts of your brain and your awareness. But as you know, in Golden Dawn magic and practice, you know, what we're doing, one of the things we're doing anyway, is we're working on and developing our psyche. And in effect, we're kind of tearing, like in the neophyte grade, you know, we do a lot of banishing and we're kind of tearing down the old things, whether it was negative programming from the past that was no longer serving you, you know, or maybe beliefs that you were holding on to that were stopping you from progressing spiritually, you know, anything like that. All this banishing is cleaning house, so that, you know, so basically breaking yourself down so that you can then take those component parts and rebuild them into a better you. You know, it's alchemy. They say salve et coagula, like on the Baphomet, you know, what that means is separate and recombine. And so that's what we're doing here. And in order to do that, you know, with this particular, you know, application of that anyway, is, you know, through symbolism. So that's really, although we do need to know the actual information contained within all of them, because like I said, you will be using it all Everything you learn is there for a reason. It will be used in a ritual or something. So, but you know, it's also there because a lot of it is subconscious, happening subconsciously. Like I said, our subconscious mind doesn't communicate with words. And so, really, you know, when we're commencing a journey like that, like you are when you start with Golden Dawn Magic, you eventually, of course, want to be led to higher realms or however you'd want to describe that. I mean, that's, you know, at least one of the main purposes for all magicians, I would assume. So, as well as the ability to connect, you know, with our own subconscious, our own superconscious, as well as our, you know, our higher self or our holy guardian angel. And like I said, as well as external things. So this is important both externally and internally. And like the Emerald Tablet of Hermes says, you know, just like as above, so below, it's also as within, so without. And I'll touch on that again a little bit later. But so, like I said before, we don't talk to these levels or energies or whatever you want to call them using normal language. And so, therefore, to communicate with these other levels of reality, we use symbols. And our subconscious mind is, as I said before, is actually much more primitive than our normal consciousness. Human beings in waking consciousness, at least in modern times, with the way our brains are, and I would say this would be referencing someone who is unawakened, you know, and or someone who is going through the process, you know, the frontal lobe is the newest part. Basically, it's, you know, it's said to be what separates us from animals. Because it contains, you know, our personality and our decision making and our sense of right and wrong and morals and whatnot. But these parts that we're working with are actually, you know, extremely old, even down to the reptilian level of the brain. And so, you know, they're just as they are primitive, so must be the way that we communicate with them. Not that it's primitive. That's really, I really kind of hate using that word, but it gets the point across. Sorry, guys. Let's make sure. Okay. All right. So, with that being said, there's an example that I can give of a kind of a similar situation, I guess you could say, in life where this could, you know, be explained. Another example of it. And the way that we interact with symbols. So our subconscious mind is more primitive than our normal consciousness, like I just explained. And the way we interact with it is by the use of symbols. Well, I'm sure you've heard, you know, these guys, the positive thinking techniques and what is it called? Affirmations. And, you know, there's a lot of different techniques, positive reinforcement techniques that people use. For example, let's say you're using a technique like that and you had stage fright, or you were scared to read, you know, in front of people. Well, you know, you would obviously then would want to visualize yourself in that situation that you want to be at. So, you know, in this case, that would be, you know, standing in front confidently, you know, not scared, obviously. So remember, I began with the question, why do we need to study the knowledge lectures? And I'll get to the main content very soon, like I said, but I want to continue with this example. So say you were afraid to be on the stage and you wanted to overcome it. You would first visualize yourself there, but in a confident manner, you know, and totally in control of the situation, without any negativity whatsoever, of course, because you know, you want to manifest what you visualize. So that's how you would visualize it. You would of course not see yourself up there, you know, with stage fright, with the problems that you normally have. That wouldn't help. You know, you wouldn't see yourself up there with stage fright and use an affirmation of, you know, I don't want to be like this. That's coming at it from the wrong way. You want to use the positive affirmation and visualize what you want. You know, I guess is the way I can put it. But so, you know, your mind then works on that image that you've developed. You know, as it does so, you can then manifest whatever, you know, you've been building up in your mind to conquer whatever, you know, issue you might be dealing with. But anyway, I don't want to get too far off on that tangent. I just wanted to make sure that everyone understood that a huge component of this is the symbolism and how we use it to communicate between levels of consciousness. So if everybody's up to speed on that, then we can start in with the main part of the lesson. Let me see, I'm trying to find something. So anyway, so when I talk about the image though, when I talk about the image, building up an image and visualizing, I don't just mean a visual mental representation of the situation. So I don't, this is the same with Golden Dawn ritual. When we say visualize, we don't just mean imagine that you see it there, you know, not just a representation of it. I'm talking about like a full sensory or as close to that as you can get representation of the thing that you're trying to represent. I mean, you know, you would want to, so in this case, if we were talking about the example of having stage fright, you know, you maybe the feeling of confidence, the smell of the theater, the noise of the people shuffling in, etc., or maybe the noise of the standing ovation you get at the end. You know, I don't know. But as long as that makes sense to everybody, you know, everything that I've just been talking about, then we'll go ahead. Because what I'm getting at here is that, you know, we need to develop a language that affects our inner levels and is not just a conscious assimilation of facts and figures. So rather than just studying something and memorizing it, you know, strictly on a purely, what would be the word, a purely superficial, you know, level, you know, you're developing something much deeper. Somebody's having problems continuing to see sit tight.
I have this covered. Don't worry about it.
Okay. Okay. So yeah, we're developing a language that we can use to communicate between these levels, you know, that goes beyond just memorization is the point of that. And to that effect, we build up, you know, a wealth of knowledge that our minds can use to communicate in, you know, between these levels that, you know, are normally impenetrable for us under normal circumstances. You also have to remember that when you start with this type of training, it's common to get, I guess, flashes of information or of feelings or intuitions. It comes to different people differently. But from your own, you get these from your own inner realms, whether it's a guide of some kind or your higher self. You know, even as a neophyte, your higher self is definitely there and is definitely doing things. You're just not in full realization of it yet. But you may get flashes of these things because you're starting to develop these connections between your conscious mind and your higher self. And you're doing that by building up these symbol sets, you know, so it's actually very, very important to the whole process. Let's see. Actually a while, I just thought of something. I had, taught this class a while back and I had a student ask a real good question. He said, when I was at this point in the lecture around here, he said, that brings up an interesting concern of mine that I've had for years, namely that I know my imagination is very good to begin with, so it would, will, and does take a lot of time or take a lot for me to believe that I'm not just creating the symbols or communication and talking to myself on that same, you know, in other words, you know, without communication between levels, you know, how does he know he's not just, you know, he's got he's sitting there, you know, it's doubts. And these are things that are good to deal with. That can be a problem with magicians. And some people get, you know, visualization, scrying and meditation and all of that quicker than others do. But if you work through the grades and you do everything correctly as instructed, you know, and these grades and this whole system is an alchemical process made up of, you know, several smaller alchemical processes. It will, you know, it will become sharpened. That ability will sharpen with practice. So, if, you know, don't let that concern you too much. So anyway, without getting too much more into that, in the beginning, you do tend to say in your journal, you know, in the beginning, you do tend to have, once you've been in the order for a year or two and you look back at your journal entries from, you know, early on when you first started working with it, you may very well find that there's what you can now tell is a little bit more fantasy, you could say fantasy or, just pure imagination mixed in with whatever, you know, whatever real was, you know, communicated. There can be a lot of times fantasy mixed in with it. And you can see that when you look back. That's one of the reasons the journal is such a powerful tool. But like I said, this will work itself out as you master it. You know, to do so, you need to train yourself to test what you receive. So that's covered in the Neophyte curriculum, of course, where they give you the, you know, the ways to test visions. Because this is very important for scrying, any vision that you may randomly have or visualizing during a ritual, etc. It's a sort of, you can use, if you have trouble with it, you really need to kind of fake it till you make it, because it will happen. But if you're having trouble with it, don't get discouraged. Just continue to do it, and it will kick in. But the practical part of the curriculum, you know, from the RMM, once you reach 110, teaches you. No. Like I said, I believe it actually is in Neophyte. It will teach you how to test such things like, you know, your visions and your scrying to be sure that you're not fantasizing or imagining you know, there's something for everything. It's based on the seven planets, and there's a Hebrew letter for each one. You know, there's one to banish intrusive thoughts. There's one to banish, you know, sexual thoughts. There's ways to test the entities to make sure they're genuine. You know, there's a lot of that, and it's very important, you know, that you test these things to make sure that you're not fantasizing, imagining, or, you know, and make sure that it's genuine. I did just check, and it is in the 00 curriculum. So it's in the RMM, the Ritual Magic Manual part, in the practical curriculum, but it is there. Okay, so excuse me, my voice is a little rough right now. Regarding testing the visions with, you test them, you know, with grade signs, and Hebrew letters, specifically the seven doubles that represent the planets. And you don't do that. You don't actually trace them physically while you're scrying. That would break your concentration. You know, this is something you're doing astrally. So you're tracing this over the image, you know, astrally. So when they say, for example, trace a resh, they mean astrally. They don't mean actually do it in front of you in the air, because like I said, your eyes will be closed during that part, during the part that you would be doing it. Anyway, I just wanted to address that because I thought it was a good question and it came up in a previous class. So we'll get back to our main subject here. So we talked about how you might get flashes of information from inner realms, as you're developing these connections. I believe that's where we left off. And also helps you, it gives you the need to have the ability to understand what's being presented to you, obviously, by whatever entity or whatever part of yourself that you're communicating with, as well as make sense of previous experiences, based on that. And also, the more that you work on the higher planes, the more abstract the information, whatever you're receiving or channeling or whatever the case may be, will be. As you get to the higher and higher realms, everything is less material and more abstract and harder for a regular human mind to understand. So it gets harder and harder as you ascend. So you definitely need to develop a system of concreting that into a form that your conscious mind can comprehend and interpret with regularity and certainty. The more that you work with this on the higher planes, the more abstract it will be, as I said. So if you think about the tree of life as an adjunct, to the actual lecture, not necessarily the part of the first knowledge lecture, but it is obviously connected. If you think about the tree of life, you'll see that through each phase of the 10 emanations, so through each whole tree, each whole lightning flash, etc., the concept becomes more understandable, more concrete, more solid, more material plane, and more understandable to our mind until it's fully manifested in Malkutha Visya, which is this, our physical plane. So, as we progress up the tree of life, we have to develop our awareness to comprehend and perceive these different energy frequencies that, we'll be receiving from, as I said, from more abstract and more abstract as we go up. And then also translate them into something that we can utilize when we, come back down to the earth plane, something that will help us in our practice. So that's why when mystics say that they have felt bliss, it is because they have attained a level of awareness that is beyond all known terms of reference, and it just is. There's just no way to describe it. It's fantastic. It's just complete ecstasy, and it's impossible to put into words because you can only describe something to a fellow human that has experienced it, really. And, that again is why we can't use English unless you were able to communicate with this person, psychically through symbols. There's and through your own, senses. There's no way that they would ever know truly how it felt for you. This can only be translated into the person's own ideal of that level. So whatever your archetype of that level is how it's going to be translated, which is why it's different for every person. So no two people are always going to have the same scrying experience just because they're scrying to the same plane, for example. excuse me one second. Allie, lay down. Anyway, so we develop a system to communicate with them that we can both understand. you know, they, these beings are on a much higher vibration and a much higher plane than us. So we need to have something that we can both understand. And it is quite difficult at first, but like I said, it becomes easier and easier as you progress and as you practice. But like, you know, and this is something that we can master, and there are differing opinions as far as how well we can master it. But, like for example, some, you know, if you were to say that you were to completely master this communication, that would be to say that you could do so all the way up to the level of Kether. And as you know, that's something very rarely obtained. So it's, you know, it's definitely possible. It's just a matter of, you know, how hard you push yourself and whether you're ready and all kinds of other things. So, but some people, for example here, let's see, how can I put this? That would be the best. Okay. So for example, speaking of Kether, like I brought up, to comprehend something like that, like Kether, may never happen for someone, at least in one lifetime. For some, it may be quicker. For some, it may just take some lifetimes, you know, whatever. Some people may get it in one, but it's, you know, there's opinions that, or even the supernals at all, you know, that the idea that you will, you know, master and comprehend that level. There's differing opinions there. And, you know, some people believe that these levels of initiation on the tree, that being the supernals, the three supernals at the top, that which make up the third order, are, you know, only possible to obtain on some kind of astral level. And then there's those who believe that they are physical. And then there's those who believe that they're both, which is what our order believes. You know, we do believe that this is definitely, we don't just believe, we know that this is obtainable. It's just, like I said, it's just, it gets to a point where it's very abstract and you have to have an extremely well-developed communication set to deal on that level. So, if anybody has any questions, now would be a good time to ask, because that's kind of the end of my little opening that I like to talk about, and then we'll get on with the elements. We'll start with the elements. If no one has a question, we'll go ahead and get started on that. Okay, so I had mentioned the bliss comment, that it can actually be compared. It's kind of crude. Well, it just depends on your, how you view things, I guess. It's perception, but you know, it's a certain, you at a certain level, awareness at a certain level is like being at, you know, can be compared to being at the peak of orgasm just for hours, you know, I mean, and that's not even all the way up. So just to give you an idea of the intensity of these frequencies that I'm talking about. Anyway, if everybody's clear on everything, we're going to go ahead and get started with the elements. And I could share my screen and put this up here, but if everyone, I'm kind of, you know, I'd kind of prefer if everybody could just, you know, maybe have their curriculum open or be looking at their first knowledge lecture. It's all there. So if you just follow along, it shouldn't be hard at all to keep up. Just keep in mind that, well, some of this information that you'll be learning in this grade and in the elemental grades is to build up this storehouse of knowledge that we discussed, so that when you reach the level of portal, before you actually enter into Tiphereth in 5-6, that you have enough a foundation built up and you've mastered yourself enough that you can begin the process of adepthood, you know, which is a whole nother process. So, and you can't really do it right unless you've done the preceding part. parts right. So it's all very dependent on, you know, always being thorough. And if you do ever slack off, just get back on it, you know. But anyway, let's see. And, oh, yeah, and remember that 5-6, once you do make it there, it really does mean that you are only just starting to learn what it is to be an adept. There's a lot more, you know, after that. So first thing that you learn as a part of the knowledge lecture is the idea of a universe based on the four elements. What are they? Well, can anyone tell me what they are? I mean, that's pretty basic. You'll see different arrangements of them based depending on what exactly you know, you're doing. Like, they may be in a certain level if you're looking at ascension of up the tree, or in a different order if you're talking about the Tetragrammaton. You know, if you're putting them in the Yod-He, Vav-He order, it would be fire, water, air, earth, you know. But putting it into the order of the grades that move up the tree of life, the way, you know, you start out in 110 at Malkuth, and then you know, in earth, and then go into Yesod, which is air, and then into Hod, which is water, and then across to Netzach, which is fire. So that gives you a different order. That's just the reverse order, you know, that you're going up the tree instead of, you know, it manifesting downwards. Now, you have to remember that when we are talking about the elements, we are referring to more than just the forms that we are used to seeing. These are all things based on the Sephira of Malkuth in Asiya. You know, that's what we know of as reality, but it's obviously not the full picture. These elements are also concepts that have, you know, hidden within them a fundamental ideology that is beyond, you know, just the physical attributes that we know of these terms, for example, fire, you know. According to lore, the elements came into being in a specific order, and I just briefly touched on that. The order is related to the tree of life. So it's like I said, it's the opposite of the grades. It's the order that they manifested in. Now, the lower grades, Sephiroth, mirror the elements of the supernals and the higher ones. So on the upper side, you know, as you reflect back and forth across the tree, you know, you'll get water bouncing back and forth, fire bouncing back and forth, and air always being in the middle. And we'll touch on that quickly at the end. But so that's their order of manifestation, and that's what I brought up before, the Yod-He, Vav-He. It's easy to remember if you remember it that way, because Yod is fire, the first He is water, Vav is air, and the last He is earth. So if you can just remember Yod-He, Vav-He, that gives you the way they manifested. So the first to manifest was fire, then water, then air, then earth. And also, you know, of course, there are really five elements, the last one being spirit, of course, the very top point of the pentagram. So we can also look at it as fire, father, water, mother, air, son, and earth, daughter. And that relates to the Tree of Life and specific Sephiroth on it as well. Air is the combination of water and fire. If you think about the Tree of Life, you know, fire begins in Chokmah and water in Bina. So that, you know, those are where they are first defined. I'm hoping you guys all know or are looking at something with the Tree of Life on it right now. So if you see that, you know, Kether is the first whirlings, and then first fire is made in Chokmah, and then water in Bina. to form air, in this case in the abstract sephira of Da'ath. It can also be looked at as, you know, their offspring rather than being Da'ath, being Tibereth, because that's also air, and the paths do lead from them. So they lead from Bina and Hokma directly to Tibereth. So that's another thing that a few people have some differing opinions on. But the principle holds going down the whole tree as well. So remember, Hokma is fire and Bina is water. Well, then they reflect. You go down to the next level and it's opposite. So Hesed is a reflection of Bina from the other side of the tree and is therefore attributed to water. And then Geburah is the same, except it's a reflection of Hokma and is fire. These are then balanced by Tibereth, which is air. Again, it's always the mediator. Netzach is then a reflection of Geburah, which is fire, you know, originally coming from Hokma. And Hod is a reflection of Hesed, which is water, which had just reflected from, or started from Bina, you know, and reflected off of Hesed. And those two are balanced by Yesod, which is again in the middle pillar, and it's air. Air is always the unifying, mediating component, alchemically. So you can see how the elements are created first in the supernals in their more abstract form, and then as they're reflected down the tree of life, with fire and water reflecting back and forth across the tree, and air always as the equilibrator, you know, meaning is it's always in the middle pillar. But you can see how, you know, the supernals, fire and water, is a very abstract form of fire and water. It's not the type of fire and that we light with a lighter, or the type of water that we drink. You know, it's much more abstract at that point. It gets to that point as it comes down to the tree. But and then, so I've covered three elements. If you've noticed, I haven't said anything about earth. Well, only Malkuth is really earth. And really, earth in the Golden Dawn tradition is more properly not its own element, but rather a container of the three primary elements, fire, water, and air. So when you're looking at the Tree of Life, the only part of even of Malkuth that is truly earth is the black quarter. The other three, you know, are its influences from the other three elements, or Sephiroth, which represent the elements. So, as I said, Earth is basically a combination of the three principal elements of fire, water, and air, and is the receptacle of the other three, which then forms the final manifestation of the physical plane of Malkuth in Asea. You know, it's the very end of the tree, unless you're going to go down into the Averse tree, which we're definitely not going to do. So this is why we use the divine names for Kether, Da'ath, Tibereth, Yesod, and Malkuth when we do the middle pillar. You know, it's the equilibrator. They're all air. They're all in the middle pillar. It's not reflecting back and forth. You know, it's equilibrated, which is what we're trying to do with our energy, especially in the beginning. You know, always, but it's very important in the beginning when building this all important foundation. You know, if you don't clean house and go through all these proper steps, then when you start doing the invocations later, you'll miss out on some seriously amazing benefits. Yesod would be air, Hod water, and Netzach fire, as I said before, and earth really only in Malkuth. You know, this is the lower part of the tree. Just to recap, And then, you know, as you will see, these reflections are after the one before, but of a lower order. So as I said, as you get down the tree, they become more material. And so when I say a lower order, I mean like a more physical, you know, exoteric rather than esoteric type of form. Okay. So, as you move down the tree of life and these get lower, they form more abstract, they go from more abstract to more physical, as I said, and but they all have an underlying idea or archetype or a principle that is linked back to the first elemental correspondences. In other words, the ones that originate in the supernal triad. That, you know, that being starting in Hokmah and Bina, and then and I guess Tibereth or Da'ath for air. So 110 is earth, as I said. That's the, you know, the first Sephiroth you will enter. 29 is air. 38 is water. 47 is fire. Portal is spirit. Portal represents spirit, and it's not a Sephiroth proper. When you're moving up the tree of life in the grades of the outer order, Kether is above, you know, all of this, as the principles from which everything else, you know, come. And it is itself a concreted form of the Ein Sof, which is the limitless light. So it even has more behind it. So it's not the be-all, end-all, but as far as, you know, the grade system goes and the elements are concerned, that's what we're dealing with. So I hope this is making sense and fitting in with your own knowledge so far here. I hope I haven't gone too far off of the path here, but I really think that these are important concepts to really understand the knowledge lectures. The elements themselves. we'll move on to the elements themselves now. So what I'm getting at here is that the four elements that you learn in the first knowledge lecture are fundamentals, not just to the physical representations, I guess, that we normally understand, but to also to their more abstract meanings that, you know, come down from the higher, which is another reason why it's important we can communicate these things. So moving on to earth, which is the first element, you know, if you're going in reverse order, the way we climb the tree as we go through the grades. In Egyptian, it has, you know, there's a couple different, before I say these, there are several different translations for the different elements. So if what you know is a little different when I give the other ones beyond Hebrew, say the Egyptian names, you know, if what you know is different, I'm giving you one form. A lot of pantheons have multiple names for the same gods, as you're aware. So anyway, beginning with earth, in Egyptian, Ta, Hebrew, Aretz, in Latin, it's Terra, and in Greek, Ge, G-E. The qualities of earth are, its main qualities anyway, are that it is passive, feminine, solid. It represents materialization, the physical, stable, slow-moving, and grounded state of the physical plane. Know that not all of what we are discussing will be on your test, by the way. I am giving you a better understanding and a more full understanding of the concepts in the first knowledge lecture. But your test will only cover what's specifically in your curriculum, just, you know, so nobody gets worried they're going to have to know everything I talk about here. So the essence of Earth is that of solidification, and that would also be its representation in the alchemical process. It also has its more abstract ideas associated as well. For example, a psychological state associated with earth is stubbornness. You also know, most of you I'm sure know, that the cherubic earth sign is Taurus, the bull. So, you know, stubbornness is a very primary psychological state associated with Earth or with 110 or with the Sephira of Malkuth, however you want to look at it. In fact, each element has corresponding psychological states that as you go through the grades will be brought up as necessary, balanced, dealt with. You know, that which you don't need at all will be banished. That which you do need but isn't quite balanced will be balanced, and that which you don't need and is not helping you anymore will be, you know, thrown away. And if there's something that you just don't have, you can gain it. So it's a way of equilibrating yourself and preparing yourself for the following work. Where would you normally see these, this is a question now, where would you normally see these corresponding psychological states being represented? This is kind of a tricky question, but think of in terms of the first knowledge lecture. You know, basically, what besides the elements and the planets do we learn about in the first knowledge lecture right away? I'll go ahead and just jump onto it. It's what I'm speaking of is the zodiac. These psychological states are represented in the 12 signs of the zodiac. And so generally, when we talk about elemental magic, we're talking about something that is making a manifested change directly in our physical plane. And we're talking about zodiacal magic. This is having an effect on our psyche and our personality, ourselves, whereas planetary magic is on a more macrocosmic level. So keeping that in mind, you know, these psychological states, as I said, the question that I asked, the answer that I was looking for is that they're represented in the zodiac and therefore within you, as the zodiac is literally the makeup of your personality. So that this is also why each sign has a triplicity. So that tells you which element rules it, as well as a quadruplicity or quality. So not only does Earth represent our bodies, rocks, pebbles, etc., but also the ideal of the alchemical idea of solidification and the concreting of form from something else, more abstract. As well, of course, as the psychological states that you find in the zodiac, like I just said. And if everybody's with me so far, we can go ahead and move on to the next element in the sequence, which is air. Air in Egyptian, neph, Hebrew, ruach, Latin, air, and Greek, the same, air, A-E-R. The qualities of air are some of the qualities of air: active, masculine, intellectual, ethereal, abstract, and communicative. Thinking of air signs, you know, signs in the air triplicity, what are some of the psychological states that you think might be associated with air based on the examples I gave for Earth? Can somebody give me an idea that they have that might be a psychological state associated with air? Okay, I being spaced out. Yeah, that's definitely dreamy, kind of daydreamy. Yeah, that's definitely a pretty prominent one, actually. So that's good. Yeah, strife, thinking, intellectual abilities, scientific thought. Sometimes maybe being distant or kind of, you know, inside yourself. These are all correct. Creativity, insight, these are also things that are related. You can group the signs together easily by their element, and doing so, see the underlying elemental dominance. You can also group them together by their underlying quality. As I mentioned before, they all have a triplicity. For example, Earth, for its triplicity, is Capricorn, Taurus, Virgo. You know, starting with cardinal, then fixed, then mutable. So that would be the triplicity. So that would tell you which element ruled it. So for that example, you know, if you had, say, Capricorn, you would know its element or its triplicity would be Earth. its underlying quality is what we talk about when we talk about heat and dryness, cold and moisture, etc. So that's its quality, and its triplicity is, of course, like I said, its element. This part's a little easier with my visual aid, but I hope that you guys can all picture what I, or understand what I'm saying. If anybody gets confused at any point, let me know and I can hopefully answer your question. But anyway, next in the order is water. And in Egyptian, we have Mu. In Hebrew, Mayim. In Latin, Aqua. And in Greek, Hydro or Hydor, depending on your source. The qualities of water include passive, feminine, receptive, sustaining, subconscious, creative, fluidic, and generative. Water also has a lot to do with anything that has cycles. Before I move on, you do all know the qualities of the four elements, correct? When I say like the qualities, I mean, like fire is heat and dryness. That's called the quality. So that's what we're talking about, I'm sure, with that. So like, you know, water is cold and moisture, fire is heat and dryness, etc. So as long as everybody's okay with that, let's go ahead and try to name some of the qualities of water, some of the psychological qualities that might go with water, psychological states, qualities. And those would be common ones are emotion, being sentimental, you know, and like I said, some of these are on the negative, more negative side, you could say, and some on the more positive side. The ones that are on the positive side, that's great, and you make them even stronger. The ones that are on the negative side that are holding you back, you either completely get rid of them or you balance them out. So none of them are technically bad, but I'd rather use the term negative and positive, I guess. Anyway, like I said, emotion, creative expression, caring, being moody, being family oriented, love, you know, these are all, water is receptive. Yes, that's very true. It's definitely, the caring, feminine figure, in opposition to, you know, you know, kind of comparing mercy and severity, I guess, in a way, with when you're talking about water and fire, that is. But anyway, so we have also compassionate. Like I said, once you've dealt with things like, you know, maybe being too emotional or being too moody, then, you know, that could turn into compassion and being able to be empathetic, etc. And also try to remember that when you're reviewing each element, what it represents in its fundamental form, like I said before, like the archetype, you know, that it represents. So last and no means least, we have fire. So fire, Egyptian, Ash or Ish, Hebrew, Osh. Latin, Ignis. And Greek, Pri. Or Pyri, depending on the source. Qualities of fire include active, masculine, spontaneous, quick, initiating, initializing, vitalizing, and energetic. So what psychological states could you have with fire then? You could have manic, you could be angry, you could be excited, you could be passionate about something, you could feel a an impulse to take action. You could be hot, you could become kind of hot-headed until you dealt with that, you know, if that was a problem. Inspiration is another big connection there. And also good old lust. Fiery passion in the sexual sense is very fiery. So you'll see that the elements are the root of a lot, if not most, of the correspondences that you'll be working with in the Alpha Omega, in the Golden Dawn system. Almost everything ties back with correspondences either to the Hebrew alphabet or to the elements. So these are when I say foundation, and I mean literally, you're literally building this part of the foundation. And if you don't know this part, you can't build the next part. So it's a literal foundation, not just a, you know, metaphorical one. Yeah, you'll see that they're the root of most of the correspondences that you'll be working with. And keep in mind that you have to learn some of the basics at Neophyte, as you'll be encountering these states that we just talked about during each of the elemental grades as you progress through them. You know, so it's good to learn about them and understand them now so that when you get to them, it's not just, surprise, I guess. And that's very important, really. It's necessary, very important and necessary to equilibrate and balance the elements properly in your sphere of sensation so that when you get to portal, when I say sphere of sensation, just to clarify, I'm talking about the aura. It's very important that you do this because once you get to portal, you'll need to then balance these four elements in equal disposition, all four of them in equal disposition under the presidency of spirit. And if they're out of whack, that can't happen. It's as simple as that. They need to be integrated and balanced in your sphere of sensation, your personal tree, if you will. And this is because in each of the grades from 1 equals 10 to 4 equals 7, you will be assimilating the corresponding energies, you know, whether it be air, water, fire, earth, etc., in a far more concentrated form through the use of invocation, you know, greater invocations. And this evokes the corresponding energies within you, within yourself and within your sphere of sensation. This means that as we go through the alchemical changes in each grade, we have to come to terms with and eventually master these elemental energies that are within you. And like I said, when they come up, there may be parts of them that aren't pretty, but you deal with it and therefore you progress. And a lot of them you may go through a grade, you don't have anything negative, you know, it's completely individual. So there's really no one answer to that question. But this is because we're striving to be at a stage, again, like I said, you're striving towards portal at this point. When you're talking about elemental energies and whatnot and the elements in general and in correspondence with the grades, your goal is to get to portal, to have finished equilibrating them. So you want to be at that stage, portal, where you can then equilibrate all of the elemental energies within you to the point that you can control yourself accordingly to then move on to spirit and higher. Which should help with what I mentioned earlier about equilibration under spirit. That's what I mean about equilibrating all four equally under spirit. And you'll, of course, learn more about that as you go. The reason for this is that when we move to the Adepti grades, we will be you'll be working with more with external energies. And if you don't have enough practice and control of the corresponding internal energies, then those without the external ones will not work for you. Basically, in other words, you need to master that which is within in order to be able to master that which is without. And like I said before, they're counterparts. They're always counterparts. So pardon me. So this, as I mentioned before, you will accomplish through working with the zodiacal invocations starting in 110, as well as the elemental ones, but the zodiacal ones specifically to work on your psyche and personality. So anyway, as I said, zodiacal rituals, they act on our personality to balance it, as we all have differing amounts of each sign or house, you know, naturally. And it's hard to put this in a way where I'm not saying too much, so I'm kind of stumbling on my words here, but more macrocosmic forces as opposed to microcosmic forces, which are internal. The micro, you're the microcosm. The macrocosm is the greater universe. So think on a more macrocosmic level. You know, you're what corresponds to those within you. So I guess I'll leave that as a little something for you to munch on. But so like the Sephiroth are actually, you know, as I said, as opposed to microcosmic forces, which are internal, like the Sephiroth, for example, as well as the averse forces or lower aspects, all of them must be balanced. In the end, everything must be balanced, whether it's ugly or pretty, etc. What you have to remember is that at a certain level, we will work with external energies like entities like angels, etc. And this work is it's on a certain frequency corresponding to, you know, that particular energy's makeup and the energy itself, which then resonates and calls those energies within you into play. So they're very much related. If we can't deal with those energies and control them from within, then we have no chance of controlling those without. Does that make sense to everyone? The neophyte grade is primarily one of purification and of balancing. That's why the rituals learned are ones of banishing and also mainly focus being on banishing, but you also have the middle pillar to equilibrate the energy that you that you're working with, and also to, you know, start to get you used to it. It's not quite invocation, but you're definitely bringing in and directing energy through your energetic circuit. So it is preparing your vessel, if you want to say it that way. So that's why the rituals learned are of those, you know, those type. They're used to clean your sphere of sensation or aura from the dross or, you know, garbage that we all accumulate, you know, through our lives, and to rebalance the energies equally within the sphere of sensation. So, you know, that's pretty much common sense, but it's not always something everyone thinks about. So point being is that the 00 neophyte grade is a kind of a preliminary grade to balance the energies within a person before they start working with the actual individual, specific elemental energies. You're working with a more, I don't want to say generic because that has a negative connotation to it. A more general, a more vague energy. You know, when you're working with just elemental energy, like in a lesser banishing ritual of the pentagram, you know, that's not a specific element that you're not doing invocation at all. But either way, you know, it's a general. Once you get into these greater ones, you know, you'll be invoking, you'll be banishing everything and then invoking only that specific thing which you want into yourself, which then gets equilibrated with the middle pillar. But sorry, I lost my place here. Okay, so remember at a certain level, as I said earlier, and I'm just repeating this because it is important. At a certain level, when we work with external energies, entities, angels, hierarchies, you know, that work on a certain frequency that's different than ours and corresponds to their plane and their energy. And this energy then resonates, which calls, like I said, calls, you know, the energies within into play. And that's what's necessary, that communication back and forth. This is why they must be balanced. It's why it's absolutely necessary for them to be balanced. The only other aspect of the elements that I would want to talk about today is the idea of rank and modality, which we touched on earlier, which is the hot and dry, etc. We'll move through that really quickly so that we can briefly cover the other parts of the first knowledge lecture without being here forever. Remember, let's see. So I guess basically, as you go through the turmoil of assimilating these things first, dealing with any negative aspects or any, you know, things that are no longer serving you, once you've gone through that, thank you, babe. Mm-hmm. Once you've gone through that, then and dealt with any negative aspects that needed balancing, you will then, you know, you'll know. It's very obvious when things become balanced. It's not something that you won't know has happened yet. Anyway. Back to rank and modality. Oh, you know what? I guess I didn't mention as far as the elements. There's of course the correspondence of the archangels. You know, earth. There's Uriel or Oriel, air Raphael, water Gabriel, and fire Michael. So you know, I didn't mention that before, but that's of course important as well. Those are the archangels for the LBRP and their elemental correspondences. You know, so when you work with the LBRP, you want to visualize those angels. When you call the angels, when you say before me, you know, Rafa, and, you know, and you're vibrating it, you want to visualize them, like say it's Raphael, you know, before me, Raphael. When you're visualizing Archangel Raphael, you should be visualizing him in the elemental flashing colors, so which would be yellow and purple, yellow and violet for the east for Raphael, you know, red and green for the south for Michael, blue and orange for the west for Gabriel, and black and white in the north for Uriel. And doing that helps you to bring these. Also helps to build up this storehouse of symbolic language, because those flashing colors and their connection to the elements is actually huge, huge, and very important. So everything is tied back together, and as you go through the grades, you'll just have aha moment after aha moment where you start seeing how everything's connected. So it's very important to pay attention to things like that. Again, like I said, the only other aspect of the elements that I want to discuss before we move on is rank and modality. As I said before, rank and modality, we're not going to spend much time on it. I did briefly touch on it earlier when we were talking about triplicity and quadruplicity. But I'm basically just going to give you the basic associations that are in the actual first knowledge lecture. You know, the four conditions: cold, dryness. I'm sorry. I'm going to give you the four conditions, you know, heat, dryness, cold, moisture. So yeah. And then how those play with the different, with the elements. So, and how those cause the elements to interplay with each other. So, okay. The basic associations, like I said, being cold, dryness, heat, and moisture. Each element has two of these associated with it, as you know. For example, fire is heat and dryness. Air is heat and moisture. Earth is cold and dryness. And water is cold and moisture. So that's simple enough, but there's a little more to it that isn't really on the test or anything, but it helps to give you a little better understanding of it. And it's what we call elemental dominance. Has anybody heard of elemental dominance? I mean, it doesn't really matter if you know it by that term, I guess, but well, you might know what I mean actually if you used to play Dungeons and Dragons when you were a kid, but basically it means that each element dominates or is dominated by another element. With the others in equal balance. So before I get into a deeper explanation of this, make a note that heat or cold, hot or cold, you know, heat or cold is the rank, and dryness or moisture is the mode. So when we talk about rank and modality, the rank is whether it's hot or cold, and the modality is whether it's moist or dry. You might want to make a note of that if you're taking notes. So an element is, you know, because of this, an element is strongly attracted to an element that has the same rank and mode, meaning the very same element. So fire would, of course, be very strongly attracted to fire because they both have the same rank and modality. An element is strongly repelled by an element that has a completely different mode and rank. So it's going to be strongly attracted by the same, strongly repelled by, you know, total opposite. So for an example there, fire is, you know, has opposite rank and modality from water. So fire is going to be strongly repelled by water. And an element is slightly attracted to an element that has a different mode but the same rank. And an element is strongly attracted to itself, same rank and modality. It is strongly repelled by an element with a different rank and a different modality. It is slightly attracted to an element with the same modality but different rank, and slightly repelled by an element of a different modality but same rank. I know that's a lot to take in. That's kind of confusing. That's why I'm hoping you guys are taking notes. So if we choose Earth for an example, this will simplify it for you all. And if you go ahead and take notes on Earth, you'll be able to easily figure it out for the rest of them. So if we use Earth as an example, it is a strongly attracted to itself. So Earth is strongly attracted to Earth, and strongly repelled by air. So again, looking at Earth, we have its rank is cold, and its mode is dry, right? So it's cold and dry. So if we chose Earth, then it is strongly attracted to itself, that being Earth, and strongly repelled by air. It is strongly attracted to itself because it has the same mode and rank. It is slightly attracted to water and slightly repelled by fire. This will eventually be used when you are doing talismanic magic and certain forms of invocation later on in your progress. But for now, a basic knowledge of it is all that is necessary, you know, when it comes to a testing level. I always say, don't worry about what's on the test, you know, learn as much as you can and master it. But, you know, I like to at least let you know that you don't need to necessarily have all this memorized yet. you know, you'll be tested. Things you'll be tested on in this are, for example, you know, what is fire? You know, the answer might be heat and dryness. You know, some you'd be asked simple questions like that, but they're not going to get into it as in depth as this. But so they're not going to specifically ask about rank and modality, but it's a concept that you do still need to understand. So I'm trying to give you a little bit of extra information to help you personally and to help you make your own connections and remember this better and, you know, later on, you know, as you go. So, and you will need it, like I said. So it's good to have a basic understanding now so that you're not, you know, completely new to it when you do get to it. Right now, I'm just teaching you the very basics of the elements and how they interact and relate to each other, which is definitely fundamental knowledge to know. So the reason for learning the heat, the hot, cold, moist, dry correspondences is to do just that, is to learn how the elements relate to each other and interact with each other. So I'll go ahead and say the rules one more time before we move on, just so if anybody didn't quite get that, they can hear it one more time. So taking as an example, Earth, its rank is cold and its mode is dry. It is strongly attracted to Earth itself because it has the same mode and the same rank. It is strongly repelled by air because it has a different mode and a different rank. Slightly attracted to water because it has the same rank but a different mode. And it is slightly repelled by fire because it has the same mode but a different rank. Does that make sense to everybody? Can I just get a couple yeses or make sure everybody's on the same page here? Everybody understand what I just talked about before I move on? Okay, thank you guys. That is how the elements relate to each other, and it's good information to have because as you develop, you know, further knowledge on top of this, if you're learning this stuff already now, you'll have an advantage, trust me. So this is how they relate to and interact with each other. And, you know, you could say like calls to like, you know, the law of attraction, it's all very similar. So a like element calls to a like element. It's another way of putting it. It's definitely by no means comprehensive as far as their correspondences go, but it gives you a foundation from which you can, you know, build on more as you go. One more thing before I go on, and that's that each element has a king, or in one case, a queen, as well as a type of elemental being associated with it. You will learn that in a different knowledge lecture, however, but just know that, for example, Earth, the earth elementals are the gnomes and their king is Gob. You know, it's something that you'll learn as you go through these grades. So, the next part of the lecture will be on the planets. And from here on out, everything is going to move much faster. I like to spend a lot of time on that stuff in the beginning because I really think it's very important. And I hope I didn't bore anyone with it, but it's something that I wish somebody would have told me when I was starting. So I like to make sure and do it. But without further ado, we'll move on to the planets. When we're dealing with the Golden Dawn, we're working with seven planets, the planets of the ancients, not nine, not 10. You know, 10 would be including Pluto. 9 would be including everything but Pluto. 7 is what we use. You know, we don't use Pluto, Neptune, or Uranus. used the two lights being the sun and the moon and the five major planets, as well as Caput and Cauda Draconis, the head and tail of the moon, which are largely similar energetically to Herschel, to Uranus and Neptune, I guess I'll say is an easier way to say it. So, like I said, the two newer planets are replaced by Cauda and Caput Draconis, the head and the tail of the dragon of the moon. That's why I like to use lights when I talk about the sun and the moon rather than planets, because that covers both luminaries, you know. The seven planets of the ancients are, and this is in order, Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, Venus, Moon, Mercury, and the Sun. And we already mentioned Cauda and Caput Draconis. Caput and Cauda are the north and south nodes, or the zenith and nadir of the mood on its only ecliptic. Each planetary symbol is composed of three aspects, and they're not always used at once. So, does anybody know what three symbols all planetary symbols are created from? There are three component parts to any planetary symbol, whether it's the sun, Mercury, Mars. They all have at least, two of these three components. So does anybody have an answer, a guess at what the three components are? Very good. Frater NL, cross, circle, arc. Yep. That's exactly correct. So the cross, the crescent, and the circle, arc, crescent, same thing. So exactly, right on. Very good. So these three symbols help us to understand, the energies and the energetic makeup, I guess you will, the qualities of the planets. I'm going to try and speed up, so we can fit everything in here. I realize this has already been kind of long, but here we go. So the circle, talking again about the circle, the crescent, and the cross. The circle is said to symbolize eternity, the never-ending, hence spirit or primal power, as well as the sun, it being its symbol. When a dot is placed inside the circle, as in the symbol of the sun, it signifies the emergence of that power. The half circle or crescent signifies the soul, and the cross signifies matter or the material world. So you have the circle representing eternity, the never-ending, or spirit. You have the crescent representing the soul. And you have the cross representing matter, or the material world. If everyone is with me so far, we'll move on to the first planet and discuss what their symbols mean. So the first one we're going to talk about is Mercury. Its symbol contains all of the three basic symbols, the cross, the circle, and the crescent. The circle of spirit is overpowered by that which is only a partial reflection. Below it is combined the earthly material matters. So does that make sense to everybody? Is everybody looking at, how do I share? Can I share my screen here? Let me see.
To share your screen, what you want to do is make some figure eights in the center of the picture. It'll make your sidebar pop up. It's the green icon to the left.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you. So, choose what you'd like to share. Wow. Okay. And we're talking about. Bear with me for 1 second, guys. Let's see. The symbols. Okay, so we want this right here. Okay, so what is, I can't see what I'm sharing. That's unfortunate. So do you guys, let's see, right now on my screen, do you see the first knowledge lecture here? And I should say yes. The old planets are set. You seeing the first knowledge lecture?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay. All right. Wonderful. So just go ahead and look at the symbols while I go through this. Right now we're talking about Mercury. So you can see again, here, now that we're looking at it, its symbol contains all of the three basic parts. The circle of spirit is overpowered by that which is only a partial reflection. Below it is combined the earthly material matters. So that's Mercury. Mercury is named after the flea-footed Roman messenger god. It governs communication, reason, intellect, rationalization, awareness, perception, adroitness, opinions, transmissions, words, speaking, writing, mailings, and means of expression. Keywords for Mercury are communication and reasoning powers. The mercurial symbol highlights, you know, through its symbolism with the cross and the circle and the crescent, it highlights that we are working from spirit over the material because we are working within that level. Communication is the abstract mind expressing itself in the physical realms. So this links back with what we were talking about before. My cat is really making this difficult. Okay. The spirit circle in the center shows that we are working, or at least trying to work from, a centered goal, but that this is shadowed by our own soul or our perceptions and reflected through matter. So that is what is meant to be portrayed by the symbol of Mercury. That's why communication as it stands at the moment is not an exact science, as we are trying to translate our own perceptions that cover all stimuli into tangible things for others to experience in the same way. Mercury is the swift messenger of the gods, and it is linked with the Hermes of the Roman pantheon, and also with the Caduceus of Hermes Trismegistus. The crescent symbolizes the human soul, or more accurately, our own slant or perspective on the real world. Again, the test will only contain the symbols of the planets themselves, but this is very helpful for you to understand and master during the neophyte grade, and puts you, or to begin to master, and puts you in a place where you are building a very strong foundation for which to work from later. We communicate about things based on our own experiences, and this might not translate accurately for everyone else to understand because they might not have had the same experiences. Well, each planet rules a sign or signs, as well as a natural house, and occupies a natural house where its energies are more intense or more condensed. We learn about the planets as they, again, represent certain aspects of our personality and psyche, but on a more macrocosmic level compared to the zodiacal ones. And this is why we learn their signs as well. Signs for the planets, that is. So Mercury is associated with the Sephira of Hod, which is also associated with the element of water, as we covered earlier. Having covered Mercury, we'll move on to Venus. Its symbol contains the circle of spirit having dominance over the cross of matter. So it's only two of the symbols. But Venus is the planet of love, and is named after the Roman goddess, and was in ancient times nicknamed the Lesser Benefic. It governs pleasure, natural love, sensuality, social ability, attraction, interaction, art, music, poetry, drama, songs, culture, beauty, marriage, unions. Its action is very mild and harmonious. When considering it on a natal chart, the power of the person to make close relationships with others and their ability to attract others into ties of partnership have a big, you know, have a lot to do with their Venus sign, where it is. That will largely depend on their Venusian characteristics. Venus rules Libra and Taurus. It is associated with the Sephira of Netzach. Oh, and by the way, I forgot to mention that Mercury rules Gemini and Virgo. I'm sorry. So, moving on to Mars, its symbol contains the circle of spirit, and the older version had the cross of matter in dominance of that, but now this is the arrow that we normally see. So the symbol that we see here in front of us on the screen for Mars is the circle with the arrow coming out. However, in older versions, it was a cross sticking out, basically the opposite of the Venus symbol, Venus upside down. So, you know, they both have the same meaning, but if you can picture that, it'll make it a little easier to see why. Mars symbol contains the circle of spirit, and the older version had the cross of matter in dominance. But this has now been replaced by the arrow, as I said. This signifies the dominance of the material over the spirit, which is the opposite of Venus. And if you think about the correspondences of Mars, you can see why that might be the dominance of the material. The planet Mars, named after the Roman god of war, was referred to the ancients as the lesser malefic, just as Venus is the lesser benefic. It governs desire, sexual energy, focused energy, dynamic action, animal natures, force, power, strife, strain, adversity, work, achievement, competition, and matters of death. The action of this planet is sudden, forceful, and disruptive. The energy of Mars can be used violently and destructively, or it can be used with valor and fortitude in a very honorable way. It again comes down to intention, like usual. So it is associated with the Sephira of Gevura, and which, as you know, is representative of severity. So this all fits together very well. It rules Aries as well as Scorpio. The next planet is Jupiter. Its symbol contains the half circle of Sol, or the crescent of Sol, to the side of and slightly above the cross of matter. So it's not, the spirit isn't completely over the cross of matter, but it's close. Jupiter, named after the primary Roman god, was called the greater benefic by the ancients. So now remember, Venus was the lesser benefic, Jupiter the greater benefic. So these are the nice planets, if you would say, if that's what they mean by the benefic, I guess. Jupiter is the lawmaker, the judge, and the benefactor of humankind. It's also sometimes referred to as the gentleman's planet. But one of the reasons that it is linked with Hesed, because of its role as benefactor of humankind, and Hesed meaning being mercy. It rules the signs of Pisces and Sagittarius. It also rules leisure time, wealth, growth, prosperity, success, opportunity, assimilation, indulgence, optimism, business, morality, as well as the higher and more abstract mind, as well as higher education, ambitions, philosophy, and luck. So Jupiter is definitely a very benevolent planet, but it's more of an earthy planet, but under the restraints of the soul. So that's why its symbol shows the cross with the soul, not completely over it, but at least in dominance of it. because it's an earthy planet, but it's under, like I said, it's under the presidency basically of the soul. So that's why the circle is next to, but slightly above, the cross of matter. The last one on our list is Saturn, which, as you can see, is made up of the cross and the crescent. This time, the cross being above the crescent. Its symbol is the semicircle or crescent of soul again, but this time, as in Mars, it is shadowed by the cross of matter. Again, the affairs of the material predominate. Saturn, named after the Roman god of agriculture, was called the Greater Malefic in earlier times. So now we've come to the end of that cycle. We've got the Lesser Malefic, that's Mars, and the Greater Malefic, that's Saturn. The Lesser Benefic, Venus, and the Greater Benefic, Jupiter. And when you look at them on the hexagram and where they relate to each other, you'll see a relationship there. This planet is known as the taskmaster of the horoscope. It rules organization, discipline, responsibility, structure, goals, career opportunities, limitations, conservatisms, new beginnings, endings to create new beginnings. It can represent death, and alchemically it very much does, as well as rebirth. But crystallized focus, restrictions, delays, theory, orthodoxy, tradition, depth, time, patience, truth, wisdom, aging, solidification, these are all things that have to do with Saturn. Saturn's action is very slow and enduring, as compared with some of the earlier planets, which we discussed that are, you know, very quick, their action being quick. So this one is slow and enduring, and it is associated with the Sephira of Bina, one of the supernals. And it's interesting to note here that it's the only planet attributed to a supernal Sephira, because after Bina, we get Hokma is the zodiac, and Kether, you know, the first whirlings. So this is the highest planet on the tree. It rules over Capricorn and Aquarius. Does anybody have any questions before I move on to the two luminaries, the sun and the moon? The cross sticking straight up or at an angle? Actually, the way I've seen it mostly is straight up, Frater Tien. Now, I don't want to say that that's the only way. There very well could have been a transitional period where they cocked the cross to the side a little bit and then turned it into an arrow just to make it more phallic. I'm not sure, but that's my guess. But yes, it would be just the opposite of Venus. So if nobody has any questions, we'll go ahead and move on to the lights or luminaries. You know what? Before I cover that real quickly, a question that came up here one time I did this that I thought was real interesting was, can we overcome and modify our natural ruling influences at will, thus overcoming an otherwise fixed position? In other words, like he's saying, say your sun sign, you know, your natal chart sign was you're under Mars. So say you're an Aries, you know, you're under Mars for your natural sun sign. Could you turn yourself into another mix of sign through these invocations? Well, you're never going to change your sun sign. You can certainly affect the amounts of energy of each sign that you have in you. Yes. So that's an important point. You're never going to change your sun sign, but you can change the levels and bring in and push out and whatnot to adjust. And then he goes on, or as magicians do, we already assume we are on the way to stepping out of being unwitting or unwillingly influenced by these powers. Now, never mind. That's not relevant. Just know that you may have a sign. Let's say you're a Gemini. You know, if you don't let that get you into the frame of mind that, you know, the descriptions that you read about Gemini is the only thing that you are and, you know, will never change, or that because you're a Gemini, you're always going to be the most talkative one at the party. But anyway, you know, you can work on those things, and you can definitely still, you know, change. You can't change your internal nature completely, but, you know, you can definitely work on those things. But anyway, moving on to the two luminaries. So the sun, its symbol is that of eternity, you know, the circle with the dot within, and of the power of spirit or primal motion. Soul, as the sun is called, and as is known in Latin, hence solar, is named after the Roman god of the same name. He was the invincible sun deity. It is the origin of the word solar, and it represents the primary masculine principle as well as men in general. It is also the fundamental expression of the individual, displaying qualities of success and leadership. Soul governs health, vitality, personal fulfillment, energy, essential principles, authority, command, rank, office, title, advancements, identity, and capacity for experience. The sun's action is very energizing and stimulating. It is referred to the Sephira of Tippereth. So not only is it the sun, but it's the sun, S-U-N as well as S-O-N. Unlike the planets that we covered earlier, the luminaries rule only one sign. In this case, the sun is ruled both day house and night house is Leo. So for soul, both the day and night house is the same. And the last of the pre-Saturnian lights being the moon or Luna, its symbol is that of the two crescents, a partial reflection of the power of spirit. Luna is a Roman name identified with Diana, goddess of the moon. The moon embodies the primary female or feminine principle and women in general. It encompasses instincts, moods, feelings, habits, the subconscious mind, the tides, as well as any other phases or cycles. Those are all big time affected or controlled by the moon. Reflections, alterations, receptivity. Luna rules needs, desires, personal interests, as well as magnetism, liquids, impressionability, fertility, and growth. And bear in mind here that its energies and its properties are going to be different depending on whether it's waxing, full, or waning, you know. So you're going to need to look into that a little bit too. Okay, the moon's action changes and fluctuates. Just as it's in charge of all these cycles, it itself fluctuates. So his action isn't always the same. It depends on, like I said, is it void of course? Is it a crescent moon? Is it a full moon? You know, it has a lot of different fluctuations to it. So because of that, I kind of see the moon to represent the inner self. And when I say that, I mean the astral or subconscious self, not the higher self. As well as the instincts and the deeper levels. That's why I see it as the inner self as opposed to the outer self or higher self, which is related to the sun. So if you look at it in that way, if that makes sense, that is a very good balance of masculine and feminine energy, you know, within you, building the lunar and solar bodies. The moon or luna rules also only one sign, that of Cancer, and is referred to the Sephira of Yesod, which is the grade of the element of air, and is in the middle pillar. Does anyone have any questions about the planets and why we study them in this lecture? It should be pretty clear, as we've already discussed in detail, the language of the subconscious in the beginning, that being symbols, and as well as the zodiac. That should be, let's see, the nodes. Ah, okay. Let's see. Did anyone here, let me check if anyone had any questions. Hey Blake, sorry you were having so much trouble. I hope you got in before too long. Let's see. Let me get back to this. Or do I need this anymore? Let me go to the part I might need. We're going to go ahead and put it on this part because we're going to talk about, or just so that in case you want to write down in your notes, you've got the dates and whatnot. Not that you don't have them anyway, but. So as I said before, you know, bringing up the nodes just again quickly, we already discussed them, but just, you know, and to cap off the planetary part of it, the nodes replace Uranus and Neptune respectively, but they refer to aspects of the moon on its ecliptic. So even though they have similar energy to Uranus and Neptune, it doesn't mean that they're the same thing, because they're definitely not. It's just that it's the closest thing that you could supplement and still have a somewhat, you know, whole system, I guess you could say. The zodiac is pretty straightforward. I'm not going to go into it very much because, you know, really you have the dates here. That's something that you just need to get used to and memorize. I won't bother reading those all out. Ram, Taurus is the bull, Gemini the twins, Cancer the crab, Leo the lion, Virgo the virgin, Libra the scales. Scorpio now can be represented either by a scorpion, by an eagle's head, and actually by one other thing too, but I'm not going to tell you that yet. You'll learn that later. There's three forms of the to represent Scorpio. Let's see, and then we've got Sagittarius, which is the archer, Capricorn, the goat. Now it's actually a sea goat, with the hindquarters of a sea animal, sea creature. And then we've got Aquarius, the water bear, and Pisces, the fishes. So as you all know, these signs are grouped into triplicities, which we touched on when we spoke about the elements. These 12 signs are distributed among the four triplicities, or sets of three signs, each being attributed to one of the four elements, present the operation of the elements in the zodiac. So I'm talking about right here. Thus to fire belong Aries, Leo, and Sagittarius. To earth belong Taurus, Virgo, and Capricorn. To air belong Gemini, Libra, and Aquarius. And to water belong Cancer, Scorpio, and Pisces. This is pretty clear cut, so I'm not going to get, you know, too in depth with any of this, as we've already discussed a lot about the zodiac. You'll find that as you progress and learn more and more, you'll find endless connections and correspondences between the signs, the planets, the elements, the Sephiroth, the Tree of Life, the Hebrew, the Enochian. It's all woven together so perfectly. It's like, what's her name? That goddess wove it on the, you know, wove these seemingly different systems together so perfectly. But Anyway, so that's the triplicities. And besides that, let's just quickly kind of touch on the Sephiroth, and then we can call it a day and take any questions if anyone has them. So the only thing we're not going to really cover here today is Hebrew. And that is because I teach a separate class on Hebrew correspondences where I will get very detailed with Hebrew. So I'm not going to do it here. It's pretty straightforward what you need to learn in at the neophyte level with that. But you will see a class about it this year by me where I'll talk more about that. So let's see. As far as, like I said, I'm sorry. Okay, so on to the Sephiroth, as I said. The Sephiroth is defined as something that the Hebrew Kabbalists referred their most highest and most abstract ideas to. They called them the ten emanations of deity, or the Sephiroth. They believed that there were 10 Sephiroth, and some occultists add an 11th invisible Sephiroth, Da'ath, which is made up of the combined emanations of wisdom and understanding, creating knowledge. Kether is the crown. Here, let me go ahead and put this up here. Or put this down here. Kether means in English the crown, and represents pure divinity and light. Chokhmah, here in gray, represents wisdom, as well as Ama, the primal father, and the sphere of the zodiac. Bina, in black, understanding, as well as Abba, the primal mother, and the planet of Saturn. The combination of Chokhmah and Bina results in the non-Sephira Da'ath, which means knowledge. Hesed, which means mercy, is associated with Jupiter. Gabura, severity, with Mars. Tippereth is the result of Hesed and Gabura and means beauty and associated with soul or the sun. So as you can see, we've got mother, father, son, but we can also look at it as father, mother, son. Although it can be said that Tippereth is the result of Chokhmah and Bina, the father and the mother creating the son, or the sun, either spelling, as I said before. So, you know, based on the path. So it just depends on how you look at that. That's something that there's differing opinions on. Netzach, right here, it means victory in green, and it is associated with Venus. Hod in English is glory, and it is orange and associated with Mercury. Yesod, or these two here, Netzach and Hod, also have a result. So if you've noticed, let's go over it first. These two also have a result, which is Yesod, or foundation, which is associated with the moon or Luna, as well as with the astral plane. So notice now that these two, Chokhmah and Bina, have a result, whether you consider that to be Da'ath or Tippereth. Gavura and Hesed have a result. Hod and Netzach have a result. And it's always the resulting ones. You've got your thesis in Chokhmah, your antithesis in Bina, and your synthesis, you know, in Tippereth. You know, and so each one of these has that, as you know, those kind of aspects to it. Well, that brings us down to the path of Tav here, leading to Malkuth. So, finally, we have Malkuth, the kingdom, the earth, as well as the as well as the four elements. It's known as the plane of the four elements. Notice that there are three triangles formed with Malkuth the only one separate. So the supernal triad at the top that's pointing upwards, it's an upwards pointing triangle that is made up of Kether, Chokmah, and Bina. That's the supernal triad. Then the next is formed of Hesed, Geburah, and Tippereth, pointing down. And lastly, the most material is formed of Netzach, Hod, and Yesod, also pointing down, leaving Malkuth as the final manifestation of the Sephiroth. The material world in which we can fully comprehend, and the world of the normal five senses. This is a world that we can comprehend as normal, unevolved people, is what I'm saying. Like normal, unevolved people or people who haven't awakened, they can still perceive pretty much everything in the physical plane, you know, but that they're not going to get any higher than that. So, and there's even plenty in Malkuth that they're missing, really. With practice, we can, of course, comprehend the others as well. And like I said before, there's different opinions on this. Some say that you can only, as a earthbound human being, you can only comprehend up to Hesed. And those that do would be the ones who would believe that the supernal grades or the third order grades are not obtainable while still in the physical body. But that's not what we teach in our order. So they definitely are obtainable. Now, that doesn't mean that those who have obtained them don't have the ability to be in the astral at all. It just means that it is possible to obtain well still on this plane. So without further ado on that, there are also, looking at the Tree of Life, there are also four worlds, but again, those are in a different lecture. There's four worlds, and there's also something where, for example, say Netzach on this tree. Within Netzach, you would have all 10 Sephiroth, so you could have, you know, Malkuth of Netzach, and that could be in Asiya. You know, so the tree gets very complex, but I'm not going to put any of that on you guys in this lecture. So after that, since we're not really covering the Hebrew, you know, since like their meaning is pretty easily found on the website, and like I said, for now you have enough to study, and once we get to the Hebrew class we'll go more into that. I think that we've about covered everything that we need to. So at this time, I'm gonna go ahead and ask if there's any questions or anything that anyone would like me to cover that I haven't yet covered. Any questions about what I've talked about or anything that I haven't covered that you'd like to see covered? Then go ahead and now's the time to ask before we close this out. So, Frater Gamel, when you said AL, what were, oh, okay. All right. Never mind. I got it. Okay. So Frater NL, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. Thesis on right pillar. Okay, well, you want to look, the way I was looking at it is for the thesis, you know, if you look at the tree as it manifests, let me turn my screen back on here. If you look at the tree, sorry, one second here. Here we go. So, looking at this tree again, the way it manifests. It manifests first into Chokmah. That's the first one to manifest. And if you follow the lightning flash, it would go from Kether to Chokmah to Bina, through D'Ath to Hesed, to Geburah, through Tippereth to Netzach, to Hod, Yesod and then down to Malkuth. So, you know, in this case, I would be saying that Chokmah would be the thesis, Bina would be the antithesis, because Chokmah is male and active, etc., whereas Bina is female, passive, etc. So they're kind of antithesis of each other. And when you combine them, you know, you get their synthesis, that being, well, depending on how you look at it, either knowledge or beauty. But does that answer your question? Or so, okay, as far as which pillar it's on, it depends on whether you're looking at a chart. When you're looking at the tree of life, like you are right now on your screen, it would be the right pillar. But when we do work, like, for example, when you guys do the QC, when you start, if you notice, when you go, after you go, Atol and Malkuth, what do? You come up to your right shoulder with Vege Vura. So you're talking about Gabura, which on this screen looks to be on the left, but it's actually on the right, because when you do these rituals, you are the tree. You're not looking at the tree, you are the tree. So really on this diagram, Chokmah is actually on the left side and Bina on the right. Because when you're doing the QC, you know, the pillar of severity here on the right and the pillar of mercy here on the left. And that's why at the end, when you say Leolam Amen, you do it counterclockwise, because then if you were somebody else facing you, as anyone would face the tree, you doing it counterclockwise translates into it being clockwise, because you are the tree. You see what I mean? So by me doing this, when you look at it, you should see a clockwise circle, even though I'm doing it counterclockwise. So that's a way to look at that should help with that. Okay, so that answered your question, or I was asking if it was consistent for all triads. As far as which side they're on, that's getting into theory and some really high stuff, because you've got to look at the way, you know, the top two are easy because we've got from the beginning of manifestation. So after this, remember Chokmah, for example, being fire, the primal fire, and then it reflects across to Gevurah, that's fire, and then it reflects across to Netzach, that's fire. So just as things reflect across the tree, unless they're in the middle pillar, so do, you know, the qualities of the Sephiroth. So you couldn't say that it always begins on one side or another. And I don't even necessarily think that it's plausible, because it would be a little bit different in each of the four worlds, the way it manifested. We're dealing up here in such an abstract way that it's a little different than how things would operate down here. I mean, it still holds, but like I said, as far as whether it's on the right or left pillar, I there's no real easy answer for that. Okay, so Blake, Christian and Kabbalistic cross, see the tree and stop on Tiphereth. See the tree and stop on Tiphereth. What exactly? I'm not real. Do you want to, could we possibly give the screen to Blake so that he can talk, maybe I can understand his question? Or can I do that? Let's see. No, I don't think I can. Hold on. Okay, yeah, so someone said they are not the tree as us. The path of the arrow. The path of the arrow is the straight and narrow path directly up the middle pillar. So, Blake, what are, okay, I see you're saying, see the tree and stop on Tifereth. That's what I'm wondering about. You say they are not the tree as us. I think I know what you mean. So what I'm saying is when I'm standing here going, Ato, after I say Malkuth, when I say Vegevura, I'm pointing to my right shoulder. But that's because I am the tree. So you, looking at me, are seeing it as the left, when on me it's the right. And that just the same way, when I'm going counterclockwise, you, looking at me, are seeing it as clockwise. So, I don't know if that answers your question or not. If not, if there's any way you can actually speak, turn on your microphone, maybe. If GH SOR DIA could help you with that, I think. Let's see.
Who is it that would like to speak?
Blake. I'm not understanding his question, I don't think.
Blake, will you please retype the question? I've lost you.
It's at the very top. You'll see that the last comment is the path of the arrow. Right under that, the two right under that. Oh, you mean on the list, maybe. I don't know. Blake, can you type something for us, please? Okay, well, I think I pretty much covered what he was asking about, but I'm just not absolutely sure, because after I did, he then came back and said, they are not the tree as us. So I just want to make sure that he understood that concept. But I think, you know, if you take it, like I said, as not looking at the tree, but being the tree. And eventually what you'll do is learn to become the central axis of the tree, so that there's actually a three-dimensional tree. So you would be the central pillar, and then there would be two pillars in front of you and two pillars behind you. So you're creating a three-dimensional tree, but that's, you know, that's getting a little more ahead of ourselves, but it's the same principle holds true, that when you're looking at it, it's what's facing you, not what you're seeing. So let's see, Blake says, I imagine the sign of cross and I ask if they know the Kabbalah or not, if the duality manpower is difficult. They start as the look, the tree on left. Yeah, I think this is just a language barrier thing. I imagine the sign of the cross, and I ask if they know the Kabbalah or not, if the duality of man power is difficult. Okay, yeah, I think what's happening here is just translation problems. So maybe this is something that, you know, we don't want to waste too much time on it. And Blake, I really do want to help you out with this, but what's your native language? Maybe if you can type your native language in, myself or somebody could help you, you know, that speaks that language. I mean, I don't know. There you go. Okay, Blake, you should have gotten a message there. That should help you with that. And I hope that what I explained at least helped you a little bit. So are there any more questions, or are we all pretty satisfied with today? I'm just glad I got through it. I'm really losing my voice, but I made it. And I hope that even though I didn't have my visual aids, that you all got something good out of it.
All right. So that was awesome. Thank you, everyone, very much for coming. I'd like to invite you at this time to check out one of our other websites. If you haven't been to magic101.com in a while, you might want to look at that. There's some free magical assistance on that. You don't actually have to purchase anything. Also, if it's been a while since you've been on to the library site, I encourage you to go on to the library and have a poke around for me. I'm updating a lot of stuff there, so if you see something that's missing, something that's copyrighted and shouldn't be there, something that isn't there that should be, then drop your tutor a line and they'll get that message to me. Is there anything else you want to add before we stitch up for today?
Were you, when you say the library, you're referring to on the member page?
Yes.
Okay, just checking. But besides that, no, I just want to thank you guys all for coming, and and I hope that you got something out of this, and you know that it helps you understand a little on a little bit deeper level the first knowledge lecture. And I also hope that I didn't confuse anybody too bad. But I thank you all for coming, and I hope that you all got something, at least one, even one thing valuable out of it, and I look forward to seeing you all again soon.
Okay, 3, 2, 1, and we're signing off.